Okay, good morning and welcome to our spring grant presentation for our Youth and Philanthropy Initiative. At this time, I'd like to ask Dr. Chavez, who's our administrator for Career and Technical Education, to join me on stage to welcome our guests.
Good morning. First and foremost, I want to thank our students for being here this morning. And especially, I would like to thank all of our 24 nonprofit organizations that are here this morning with us, joining us. I want to say a few things just about what I think about philanthropy. And one of the things that comes to mind right now is that it's easy to think about the gift of giving and serving others. I think that's very important. Dr. Diane Garza, thank you so much for being that leader and helping us and making a difference in Bronzeville. And the nonprofit organizations, again, thank you for making a difference each and every day. No matter what entity and what nonprofit organization you belong to or the purpose behind it, I know it's for the better good. And also our students, very important for you to continue serving our community. You know, I know it was a tough decision trying to make the selection and choosing two finalists, but I think at the end of the day, we know that we do it for the betterment of Bronzeville, our citizens here in the community. So again, thank you, welcome everybody, and let's celebrate. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chavez. I'd like to introduce Dr. Cuff, who's our Assistant Superintendent for Curriculum and Instruction.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome all of you here, all of our students here. You're looking very bright and eager and ready to go, and that's great. I'd like to welcome also our nonprofit organizations here. I'm doing this on behalf of Dr. Hatton. She may be here, our interim superintendent, and if she comes in, we'll welcome her as well. But what I just really want to say is what a great job this is to collaborate between our schools and the nonprofit organizations that are out there. It's the collaboration that makes Bronzeville what it is between the entities of Bronzeville and the Bronzeville ISD School District. So from our offices at the central office, we'd like to thank all of our students that are involved and all of our nonprofit organizations to make this a very, very worthwhile event today. And I know that it's gonna be tough from what I hear. That's what Dr. Chavez said, it's gonna be tough, but at the end, I think everybody's a winner. Everybody's a winner. So thank you to all of you and have a great morning.
Thank you, Dr. Cuff. At this time, I'd like to introduce Dr. Diane Garza, who will be speaking on behalf of both foundations who have made this initiative possible, the Bronzeville Community Foundation and the Bronzeville Foundation for Health and Education. Dr. Garza?
I just would like to welcome everybody once again. This is our, our fourth year. We run in semesters, of course, because we're going with the school district, so this will be our eighth semester. The grants that the students give away is about an extra $30,000 per year back into the community to help serve the needs of Brownsville. And it is really a celebration in collaboration, number one. And number two, we hope really that the biggest takeaway is for our students that get to experience this when they're so young. And maybe it will lead you into thoughts of a career in the nonprofit world as you get out of school and get ready to make your choices in life. And I know you've had a chance to talk with your classroom mentor, also with the nonprofit administrators and workers that you've been able to meet, and they'll tell you what a great life it is to work for the greater good. So we're hoping that that will be the great takeaway for our students and then for our community. Just the idea that our students are involved with our nonprofits and are giving back. So thank you once again.
Thank you, Dr. Garza. At this time, I'd like to introduce our two Masters of Ceremony for today's presentation. We have Albert Alcala and Cristian Maldonado from PACE.
Thank you, Mrs. Sykes. The Brownsville community has many nonprofit organizations providing valuable services to our residents. This initiative gave us an inside look at the great things that nonprofits do in Brownsville. It also gave us an opportunity to see what kinds of careers are available in the nonprofit world.
Each early college high school philanthropy class was assigned four nonprofit organizations. We researched each one of these nonprofit organizations as well as participated in site visits. Once we visited all of our assigned sites, we had to narrow it down to two nonprofits. This was a difficult task as we realized that all nonprofits have a real need for various resources. We sent these two finalists a request for proposal, also known as RFP. After nonprofits submitted their RFP, we made a decision on the recipient of the $2,500 grant.
We will begin our grant presentation by calling up each early college high school philanthropy class. Each class will have student representatives speak on behalf of their class. These representatives will share insight of their experience with this initiative, and then they will announce a grant recipient.
We would like to ask Ms. Belinda Morales, Hannah Early College High School philanthropy teacher, and her class to please join us. Speaking on behalf of Hannah Early College High School are Abby Morales and Jorge Martinez.
Okay. Hi, so good morning. My name is Abby Morales.
And I'm Jorge Martinez.
And today we will be presenting our philanthropic journey on behalf of Homer Hanna High School. So at this time, we would like to start off with a video. As you all know, philanthropy, it derives from the Greek origin and it means mankind, the love of mankind. And so this video is just sort of a symbol for this. So as you can see through the video, one of the many things that we learned throughout the duration of this year was that when you are working together, When you work together, you are able to accomplish much more than when you are working alone. So you can bring color to your life, like in the video. And that's one of the many things that we learn through these nonprofit organizations. They're working together for the betterment of our community.
So we went ahead and visited four nonprofits, and those four nonprofits would be Brownsville Wellness Coalition. We also visited Gladys Porter Zoo, Brownsville Animal Defense, and Girls on the Run. This would be our table of contents, which is basically the order we're going with. And as you guys are seeing, those are like, as well, the four nonprofits we visited, except for Girls on the Run. They went ahead and came to our campus. And then from there, we're gonna go ahead and talk about our two finalists, and then our acknowledgements for everybody that helped out, our grant, and then our grant recipient. Our first place that we visited was Brownsville Wellness Coalition, and their mission is to, cultivate healthy food and lifestyles. Their spokesperson, or the representative, is Danny Cuevas, and we went ahead and went to the Lemongrass Gardens. They have been working to improve our community's healthy through education and prevention by adopting programs that engage our community gardens, farmers markets, healthy cooks, and walking clubs. And that cuts down on risks for disease by growing their own food, and they reduce crimes by increasing productivity in farming in our neighborhoods. And we learned that farmers aren't basically just like in the commercials, you know, they just farm to farm. Well, we learned that they're mostly like scientists and entrepreneurs. The big concept is that in our neighborhoods, or at least in our community, we have 80% of our community is overweight, 30% is obese, and 25% is diabetic. One of the programs that they offer is the Happy Kitchen and the Coalition and the Cocina Alegre. And what they do there is that they have cooking programs and nutrition programs, and it's an interactive 6-week series of classes which emphasizes the selection and preparation of fresh seasonal foods and nutritious, economical, and delicious. The classes meet once a week for 1.5 hours to cook, discuss, and learn together. Everyone leaves each class with recipes and groceries to practice new cooking skills.
So this brings us to our next slide. The second nonprofit organization that we visited was the Brownsville Animal Defense. How many of you have heard of Brownsville Animal Defense? Raise your hand. Okay, yay. Okay. So Brownsville Animal Defense, they are looking for foster families for dogs, as best described by Ms. Tessie Sarmiento. And Brownsville Animal Defense has actually saved or adopted over 2,000 dogs. And so their vision is to have a healthy dog in every home. And as you can see in this picture, after visiting Brownsville Animal Defense, I was actually inspired to adopt a puppy. So I've had Snoopy. Yeah, meet Snoopy. Right now, he is 4 months old. We've had him for about 2.5 months, and it has been the best 2.5 months of my life. No, I'm kidding. I love Snoopy so much. We bought his outfit. It's a raincoat and rain boots. And they actually have a thrift store in the Brownsville Animal Defense facility. So it's like a thrift store, a secondhand store where you can get clothes and different materials for your dogs. So it's really neat. So some of their values and their mission is to make the RGV a no-kill community through the adoption of healthy dogs, and they work within the local animal shelter, and it educates the public about humane dog care. And the values include that every dog has a right to be healthy, happy, and free from abuse, neglect, and cruelty. So these are some pictures from the Brownsville Animal Defense. They have different breeds, different sizes of dogs. I really encourage you to go, at least look at them or volunteer. Some of the goals that they have is to advocate for the dogs in need, to reduce dog population and abuse, build organization and financial capacity, and the goal four is to build a dog safe haven for every animal. So how it works. The foster program allows us to rescue, socialize, and place dogs and cats into loving homes. And it's important because it offers our dogs a warm, safe, loving environment and finding that forever home. And now I will be moving on to Gladys Porter Zoo, which was the third nonprofit organization that we visited. The Gladys Porter Zoo was established in 1971, and it's going on its 50th year anniversary. There's gift shops and grants, and that is the main source of their funding. $5.2 million is needed for the zoo to operate just for 1 year alone. So that's a lot of money, $5.2 million. And 92% of its budget is made through admissions. So the educational budget that they have for summer programs, the ranger program that they have, where they educate children of all ages, they have their training zookeepers, that budget is $8,000. So each year there's about 400,000 visitors, and the city of Bronzeville pays 7% of the 5.2 million need that the zoo needs each year. Every 3 years, the zoo is tested, and it is supposed to be accredited. An accredited zoo has to pass the test, and we are lucky that our zoo has always been an accredited zoo, and that's an honor that our zoo has. The educational director is Sergio Garcia, and he was explaining to us how the zoo needs a lot of money in order to maintain it, $5.2 million a year. And there's new exhibits, and there's a need for space for some of the animals. And it's kind of a process because, as we had mentioned previously, 92% comes from admissions and visitors. But people don't want to go to the zoo if they don't see new exhibits or new animals. So it's kind of like a never-ending cycle. How are they supposed to attract people if they don't have new exhibits? So that's something that we should definitely keep in mind, and that's where the zoo is at. Oh, and behind us, in the bottom picture, where the tree is, that's a new exhibit that they put in place for the monkeys. And on the top picture, he was explaining that they are needing to, the vision for the future is to, in that enclosed area where they have the, it's kind of like an abandoned theater, but they want to make it into an auditorium, an indoor auditorium where they can have shows. So that's something. And these are some pictures that we had. I know when we were little, well, at least me growing up, we didn't have the stingray exhibit. And I have a six-year-old sister, so now her class, her generation growing up, they're able to see that stingray and aquatic exhibit. That's a way that they have been making improvements and renovating the zoo. As you can see here, the Dawn of the Dinosaurs exhibit, I know my entire class really enjoyed it, like we felt like kids again. And that's just an overall view of our visit to the zoo. Last quote, it says, this attraction is one that not every city or town has. This is your zoo. So that's one thing that Mr. Sergio kept repeating to us, that it's our zoo, it's our job to keep it running.
Okay, so this is Girls on the Run, and their board of director was Melissa Muskies. And what they do is that they build up girls' self-esteem and boost up their confidence. And something that they kept on in telling us, at least, was it's not so much about winning, it's more about helping them out. It's not about the competition. It's about educating the girls, maintaining a healthy diet through activities, and they also try to encourage involving them more in school activities as well. And they wanted money, or at least they needed money, for the girls' scholarships and to help the cost of joining the program, as it is a little bit expensive. Their mission was that they inspire girls to be joyful and healthy and confident using a fun experience curriculum which creatively integrates running. They mostly focus on third to fifth grade girls, and the duration of the program is 2 days out of the week for 10 weeks. At the end, their goal is to run a 5K. Their goals would be to embrace the unique and joyful Girls on the Run spirit, Utilize coaching strategies to lead the session with your team and implement the curriculum with confidence.
So at this time, can we have a representative from the Gladys Porter Zoo, Bronzeville Animal Defense, Girls on the Run, and other nonprofit organizations? If we can have all four representatives, please come up. Bronzeville Wellness Coalition. Can we have the representative from each walk up? Please, give them a round of applause. Okay, so at this time, we would like to thank you all, give you a token of appreciation for all your efforts for our community. You all make a difference, and we want to let you all know that we really appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you. Y'all can have a seat now. So we'll be moving on. Before we announce what everyone's waiting for, which is the grant recipient and our finalists, we want to make a like commercial break. So we're gonna give special thanks. Okay, so special thanks to Dr. Garza, who implemented and established this program. Without you, none of this would have been possible. We really appreciate that you're giving back, that you started this foundation of giving back to our community. And it really means a lot. It's probably one of the best collaborations that Bronzeville BISD has seen. So thank you for that. And Dr. Chavez, thank you for your continuous effort within the CTE program. Ms. Sykes, who is an amazing and hardworking individual, thank you for always helping our community out. And to our sponsor slash teacher slash mom, we love you. I know, like, I'm not just speaking for myself. Like, we appreciate you and, like, always putting up with us. So thank you with our craziness. Ms. Lambari, who is our Homer Hanna High School principal, round of applause. And Dr. Salceda, who is our area's superintendent, and of course our superintendent, Dr. Haddon. So round of applause for these individuals.
So our two finalists, or at least the two people that we chose to be like the most important ones, at least from our vision, would have been Brownsville Animal Defense and Gladys Porter Zoo.
Drum roll, please. Gladys Porter Zoo, please make your way up here. And that concludes our presentation. Thank you again.
So at this time, we would like to ask Ms. Virginia Ramirez from Lopez Early College High School Philanthropy and her class to please join us. Speaking on behalf of Lopez Early College High School, Martha Smith and Jennifer Cisneros.
Good morning, my name is Martha Smith. I want to thank all the nonprofits and BISD. I want to also thank Ms. Diana Garza. Garza court appointed special advocates. Their mission is be an independent voice for children who have been victims of abuse and or neglect in Cameron and Willacy counties. GAS is a national volunteer movement that acts as a voice in court abuse and neglect children. GAS makes sure that the children is in a safe and secure home. They also make sure the foster parents are suitable for the child. Provides through thorough training for those who volunteer in order to prepare for them for any cases or situation. GASA works hand in hand with CPS, which is known as Child Protective Services, to ensure a full attention to the child's needs. GASA is one of the organizations that is needed for a big heart because the trust of a child is difficult to gain when they have gone through so much. Being there to take them out of a situation of a troubled home is difficult, and this is what we have learned. You showed us how we can make a difference in people's lives and be a voice for those around us. Thank you for making us feel at home while we were at your organization. You were very inspiring with your words.
The next nonprofit that we visited was Moody Clinic. What do they do and who do they serve? So Moody Clinic provides rehabilitative services such as speech and language therapy, physical therapy, occupational therapy, and orthopedic needs. They help disabled children. Patients that graduated from the Moody Clinic now volunteer there as well. They help the families of disabled children who qualify for their services by raising money. About 32% of the patients don't have insurance. They have events so that the patients' families get involved and the workers are friendly and love to interact with the patients. The workers try to meet every patient's unique standards.
Tip of Texas. Tip of Texas is a family outreach, is a nonprofit organization where it provides supporting services to families who are going through difficult times, especially those who need help with child care, guidance, and strong support. We thank you for allowing us to have this great experience in which we learn a lot about Tip of Texas family outreach and how they contribute to making our community a wonderful place to live. Tip of Texas family outreach showed us that there is a grand possibility to make the world a greater place to live in, and that there is a solution to every problem as well as support and guidance whenever needed. Here at Tip of Texas, we are one of the many programs that are provided to public for teen parents and parents that already have kids that are struggling. And you can see here where one of the programs is called My Baby and Me. And it just basically talks about how they teach kids, well, teen parents and kids from ages 13 and older or getting pregnant at a young age, and they teach them how to properly handle a child and raising them and making sure they're suitable in their homes where they live in.
And the last nonprofit we visited was the Ozanam Center. The Ozanam Center take care of homeless people and immigrants by giving them breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They give them shelter for a month depending on their unique situations. The director, Victor Maldonado, helps them get a job during the month of their stay. The Ozanam Center shelter also serves as an emergency shelter. They give out clothes during hurricane and cold weather seasons. The Ozanam Center has an educational center for children and adults. Math, computer science, and English are some of the subjects for both the immigrants and homeless to get certified, to have a stepping stone to get a better job, to level up on the poverty scale. They also provide classes for the children that are being helped by the BISD teachers and supplies to run the small school-like system to help the kids further their lives. It was a great experience and a pleasure being in the Ozanam Center. We saw how they give shelter to the homeless and other families who are in need, and also how they distribute the clothes to the people that are there. They call it the thrift store. Thank you for your services.
And the recipient is... the Ozanam Center.
We would like to ask Ms. Nancy Ortiz, Pace Early College High School philanthropy teacher, and her class to please join us. Speaking on behalf of Pace Early College High School are April Alejos and Daphne Moreno.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Daphne Moreno.
And I'm April Alejos.
We will be speaking on behalf of our James Pace Early College High School philanthropy class. So our four nonprofits are Infant and Family Nutrition Agency, Monica's House, Foundation to Support Proyecto Juan Diego, and Friendship of Women. If you guys could please come up to receive a small token of appreciation, please. First and foremost, we want to give a special thank you to our class mentor, Mr. John Cowan, for supporting the Youth and Philanthropy class.
Our first nonprofit is the Infant and Family Nutrition Agency, with the mission to give children in Cameron County a chance for a healthier start in life by equipping their families with the most current information about prenatal nutrition and health, breastfeeding, and infant, toddler, and family nutrition. We learned that being a mother is definitely not an easy job. So with that, we want to thank our teacher for being more than a teacher, but our second mom.
Our second nonprofit agency is Monica's House, with a mission to provide and advocate for child victims of abuse through prevention, intervention, and treatment. Thanks to their special services, they've helped children and families get through rough situations. For a change of scenery, here's us having a special treat after going to Monica's House and the Infant and Family Nutrition Agency. Our next nonprofit agency is Foundation to Support Proyecto Juan Diego. Their mission is to empower low-income families to be healthy and self-sufficient community members through educational programs, family activities, and preventative health services. Thanks to them, they've helped people to have better lifestyles.
Our last nonprofit agency is Friendship of Women, to provide leadership and comprehensive service to empower and promote safety, health, and the overall well-being of adults and children impacted by family and sexual violence. We seek social change through advocacy, education, prevention, and provide safe homes for victims and their families. And our recipient is Foundation to Support Proyecto Juan Diego. You guys could please come up.
At this time, we would like to ask Ms. Carmen Zapeda from Port Orly College High School and her class to please join us. Speaking on behalf of Port Early College High School, Brianna Garcia and Luis Armandariz.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Brianna Garcia, and I am the proud president of the Gladys Porter Early College High School Philanthropy Group. We want to give a round of applause to the following four organizations we attended and our advisor. Ms. Jessica Averett from the Brownsville Junior Service League, Paula Gomez and Hilda Gonzalez, the Brownsville Community Health Corporation, Pablo Quintanilla from the Gorga Science Foundation, Nick Mitchell, the Brownsville Community Development Corporation, and lastly, Dr. Arno Forrest, our advisor. We would like to thank our advisor, Dr. Arno Forrest, for taking time out of his busy schedule to talk to us about the good in philanthropy and why it's important to every single community. Dr. Forrest told us that he started helping students in our area when he noticed a lack of educational opportunities in the accounting doctoral programs here in the Rio Grande Valley. He also saw a lack of representation of his culture, so he started the UTRGV German Club. His amazing nonprofit focuses on educating the youth on the German culture, specifically the language. At the end of the year, he organizes a trip for his students to set flight to Germany for a month to get the authentic German experience and to continue their education on the language. He also organizes and hosts the Volkfest. It's the largest German spring festival in the valley. Dr. Forrest left us with the message that philanthropy is very humbling as well as a fulfilling experience. On behalf of my classmates, we would like to thank Dr. Diane Garza, Brownsville Community Foundation consultant, Dr. Sylvia Ann Reyna Hatton, interim superintendent, Ms. Alma Cardenas Rubio, area superintendent, and lastly, Dr. Juan Chavez Jr., CTE administrator, for the great opportunity to be part of the Youth in Philanthropy Initiative.
Hello everyone, my name is Luis Armendariz. I am part of the Gladys Porter Early College High School Youth Philanthropy Initiative. It is an honor to be here today to recognize the nonprofit organizations that we visited and share our experiences. The Gorga Science Foundation was one of the amazing nonprofits we had the honor to visit. Since the mid-1960s, this organization has provided exceptional education on the ecosystem and has brought awareness to encourage the conservation of our environment. When our class arrived at the location, we were warmly welcomed. We were given an incredible presentation about the history of this organization and its surroundings by a gentleman named Pablo Quintanilla. We were informed that the Gorga Science Foundation was the only area in the United States that is home to the rare sable palm trees. This foundation is filled with an immense amount of history. We can even go as far as saying that it's considered a landmark. After being informed, we had the opportunity to have a tour around and inside the facility. The view of the trail we walked was very well kept and a sight for sore eyes. We saw different types of birds, which were amusing to watch. This organization has changed our perspective for the maintenance of the wildlife and our environment. In addition, we also had the opportunity to visit the Honorable Brownsville Community Development Corporation. This corporation has given so much to this community, especially the youth. Their purpose is to grant the community with affordable, comfortable, and modern homes. In unity with this, they have a program called Youth Build. They provide the youth ages ranging from 6 to 24 with free education to get the GEDs. This resonated with us because they provide the youth ranging from 24. They're standing with us because the students are teenagers just like us. It struggles being one and having personal issues on top of that. This gives them a second chance at education and, in the long run, a second chance at life. We arrived at the location and were immediately greeted with a welcoming smile from the Youth Build Operator, Counselor Janet Frico. We then proceeded to enter a classroom where she informed us about the history and development of the corporation. The presentation was very expansive and we were satisfied with it. After that, we were gladly taken a tour of the facility. We saw some of the classrooms and they even had a garden outside, which is fascinating to us. We left with a great insight of how Youth Build operates.
Now, if we could proceed with the finalists. Our first finalist is the Outstanding Brownsville Community Health Corporation. This nonprofit provides all types of medical care for patients at free to low cost, depending on their financial status. We were welcomed with open arms into their beautiful facility. There, we were presented with a very resourceful PowerPoint informing us of various programs they provide for the community, those including adult medicine, behavioral health, dental services, and diabetes education. Furthermore, after the presentation, they allowed their beneficiaries to talk about how the organization impacted their lives. All of the testimonies were hard to hear because of the hardships they had to go through before finding the clinic. The visit was definitely an eye-opener. They mentioned that the social workers were their guardian angels. They called them angels because they were with them all the way through their fight. This organization will fight with you and assist you with everything they have. They will not leave a stone unturned for your health. Thanks to this organization, they were able to tell their story. And if BCHC continues to assist in the community's healthcare, we are sure that more people will live on to tell their experiences. Given that, our second finalist is the Brownsville Junior Service League. BJSL was founded in 1939 by a group of women and continues to be led by amazing ladies. They focus on promoting economical, educational, and cultural conditions in Brownsville, focusing on the well-being of children and women. The wonderful president, Jessica Averett, welcomed us so greatly. She gave a very informative presentation. They often collaborate with other organizations as well. Also, Ms. Averett notified us about all the life-impacting projects they organize. One that really provoked emotion from our part and hers as well was a teddy bear project. This project gives young children a companion, a teddy bear. It brings a sense of stability and support to kids who are ripped away from their homes in an instant without warning and put into foster care systems due to physical and mental abuse. It was notable that Ms. Averett was speaking from the heart and builds a special bond with every child she comes across. The Brownsville Junior Service League really humbled all of Porter's philanthropy. It made us reflect what virtues one must possess: being grateful, supportive, giving, selfless, and loving.
Philanthropy, along with this organization, we had a great impact on the community. It has brought an amazing feeling of accomplishment by helping people. Also, it has helped our class to grow together. We have become more than just a class. We have created a stronger bond. On behalf of Porter's Youth Philanthropy, we are extremely thankful that we have been exposed to the nonprofit world. Philanthropy isn't only about donating money, but also our time and effort. It is important not to just spread awareness, but also take action and make our words into reality. This class has become life-changing, and we will continue our efforts in helping out the home of Brownsville, Texas. Weeks after our visit at BGSO, we had the chance to team up with the Brownsville Junior Service League to create 700 beautiful Easter baskets, the grandest project yet. It was truly amazing to be part of this wholesome experience. We weren't only lending a hand, but also having such an exhilarating time bonding with the family of BGSO.
Before we announce our recipient, we ask that our advisor and the representatives of these organizations please come to the front to be recognized to receive a small token of appreciation. We want to show our gratitude for allowing us to visit your organizations and for truly showing us what philanthropy is all about. Dr. Arne Forrest, our advisor. Ms. Jessica Averett from the Brownsville Junior Service League. Paula Gomez and Hilda Gonzalez, the Brownsville Community Health Corporation. Pablo Quintanilla from the Gorgas Science Foundation. Nick Mitchell from the Brownsville Community Development Corporation. So this is a tough decision. But now, for the moment we have all been waiting for, the Porter ECHC 2500 grant recipient is...
BCHC!
The Brownsville Community Health Corporation. Become the poor.
We would like to ask Ms. Angie Capistran, Rivera Early College High School philanthropy teacher, and her class to please join us. Speaking on behalf of Rivera Early College High School are Felipe Cantu and Alexandra Escobedo.
Be careful.
Good morning, guys. I hope you guys had a fantastic morning on coming here. And this is my partner, Alex Escobedo. And we're currently representing the Rivera Early College High School Philanthropy Group of 2019. What philanthropy means to my class of 2019. Philanthropy has taught us that if you want to see your community grow, advance, you have to give back to it with either generous donation, publicity, and most valuable one of them all, your time. Because time is something that can never, nothing, you can't get it back. Once you use it, it's forever gone. And so like my parents said, make your time worth, like do something that will help the community, help yourself, help your family. This is another quote I actually like. You want to be the pebble in the pond that creates a ripple of change, for change. So hopefully this like our philanthropy group, it helps improve Brownsville community and makes us strive to become really good and like to help other people out. That's what I see for us to come and for us to like to accomplish. And here's some of our work, our volunteer work that we did.
We did an event called Potty. This helped Brownsville Animal Defense to educate others how to love their animals, keep them clean, and what they need to stay healthy. Here are some of the pictures of our students. If you see those little purple plates on the floor, those are cupcakes. We had some of the puppies have an eating cupcake challenge. And we also had their owners and other animals, which is the dogs, dress up, and they did like little activities around. They had, mainly the kids came, and they had the Paw Patrol characters there. And then here are some more pictures of them like putting the cupcakes on the plates. And then they usually had to like raise up their hand when a dog finished their cupcake to be the winner.
And what was really cool about this event that we went to is that I knew that there was dogs that were in the streets that had no owners or anything, and they were just strays. And this opened my eye to, instead of just buying from people who are selling them, to adopt, because there's actually a lot of dogs that are in shelters that are about to be put down in like a week or two. And I'd rather have myself and my family to help like those dogs that are usually mistreated and just given to a bad family. And I would encourage like a majority of you guys, if you're gonna get a dog or a cat, I say adopt, because I mean, you'd want to be happy with your dog and see them thrive. Well, here are three nonprofit organizations we visited: Project Space, Good Neighbor Settlement House, and Brownsville Literary Center. And the locations for Project Space was in UTRGV, Good Neighbor Settlement House was in 1254 East Tyler Street, and Brownsville Literary Center was 245 E. Levy Street in Brownsville, Texas.
And this is our first nonprofit organization we visited, was Project Space. Project Space was known as Friends of ARC, the Friends of CARA, and now it's officially Project Space. Project Space is a program of hardworking young scientists putting their effort and time and knowledge to create awareness and advocates for the students of Aerobic Remote Command Center and the Center for Advanced Radio Astronomy in UTRGV. You can also visit their website, projectspaceurgv.com. And then here are some pictures. This is one of the students. She actually went to a college, a university up in state, and she had some trouble up there, so she moved down to Brownsville, and she actually experienced more here than up there in Texas. Project Space raises money to help with summer programs, internships, travel, and other experiences that a student may obtain throughout their college years. During our tour, we were able to hear a testimony of a grant recipient and how it helped her. Through this program, this student has been able to attend the Internship Space conference, travel to Los Angeles and Washington, D.C. One of the students who are involved, they also met some of the, some astronauts that went up into space, and they have events. If you visit the website, and they also have a Facebook, they have events where you can meet many people and people that are involved in space. So it's really good. I love seeing the stars at night, and like I love the moon, and just I love this.
Our next nonprofit is Good Neighbor Settlement House. Good Neighbor Settlement House is a nonprofit organization that has been assisting the community for 65 years. They provide for the people that have low income, refugees, and the homeless. And low income, I'm pretty sure you guys are thinking is like, X amount of money. No, it's people that are barely making it. Like, they have no light, they have no running water. They have nowhere to clean their clothes or anything. And Good Neighbor Settlement House helps with that. They provide 3 meals, a shower, and medical treatment. And surprisingly, a lot of people are hurt and they have like little cuts and bruises, and they don't have the money, or they don't have no ways of getting treatment for it. And a lot of them eventually get infected, stuff like that, and it gets very bad for them. At the moment, the fluctuation of illegal immigrants, they have been providing temporary shelters, bus tickets, airplanes, and medication. So I'm pretty sure y'all are aware of what's happening right now. We're having so many X amount of people come over, and they're like struggling. They have no family, no food, nothing. They're just stranded there. And I'm pretty sure the Chiefs? Someone from the Chiefs came down to help out, give water and stuff like that. People were waiting in line, help them out. And I believe it's gonna get more and worse as time goes on, as we're seeing things. I think it's gonna get a little bit bad, and I do believe Good Neighbor Settlement House does need a lot of help with this. Hopefully this opens the eyes of other people to volunteer there. It's really fun. I met Jack White, this super humble guy, awesome, like easy to approach. He's not scared or nothing. Like, you know, I know a lot of people that are like, they're shy, and they're like, I don't want to approach someone like random, but no, he's super easy to approach. And it was awesome. It was an awesome experience he introduced to us. Brownsville Liberty Center. Brownsville Liberty Center has been serving the community for 32 years. Over the years, they have improved as to what they offer to the Valley. At the moment, they provide English as a second language course. There are 3 levels that they can do. They offer beginner, intermediate, and advanced courses. They also have a program called Family Literacy Program. This program allows parents to bring their child to a small daycare in the facility and joint effort teach the young child how to read. This is pretty cool, because as in Brownsville, I know a lot of, like, my grandparents, only my grandma, I call her Tita, she doesn't know English that much. She understands it, but as in our day and age, English is the dominant language. She needs it to, like, go around all over the valley. And I actually wanted to get her a class in the intermediate, because she does know how to read and write. But unfortunately, I was gonna get for her for Mother's Day, but unfortunately she wasn't here. She was in Mérida, Yucatán with my family helping. And I was really hoping to give her that, because that would've been cool and that would've been nice for me. And it would've taught her, it would've improved. Like Kevin Hart says, your biggest enemy is yourself. I do believe that if you can't cross, you're your own problem. If you can't figure out your own problems, I mean, no one can really help unless you figure it out yourself. And I do believe that you have to figure out everything. Like, no one can really help, truly help you, unless you help yourself.
And then And we want to give a special thank you to our class mentor, Melissa Mesquite. She came to the event and explained more on what types of careers are possible in the nonprofit world. Ms. Mesquite also spoke about the trials a nonprofit has. And then here are some pictures where we went to go eat. Sorry for Felipe closing his eyes. We went to eat. We all talked about, which is at Row House, these two. We talked about Project Space because that was the first one. And then the last two on top, these two, we went to Cheddar's. And then we talked to the...
We were talking over which one, like, personally did, what made you an eye-opening. And personally, I thought the Good Neighbor Settlement House, a lot of people were the good, Bronze Literacy Center. And that's where the majority of what we were talking about in those two. We actually did a little extra event. I mean, it never hurts anyone. As a team, we decided to raise money. We decided to raise money and a grant to the Bronzeville Animal Defense. We held a car wash at the moment. At this moment, we were proud to grant the Bronzeville Animal Defense of a money order of amount of $360. Can someone from Bronzeville Animal Defense come up, please? This grant.
This is great. Thank you. Thank you very much.
No problem. What's funny about this day is that out of all the days that we chose, this one day it started pouring. It was horrible outside. Like, literally, it was like, out of all our luck, it had to be on that one day we were doing the fundraiser. And it was just pouring, there was lining, it was horrible. Luckily, it cleared up and we got a couple car washes in. We sold tickets, it was a fun experience and we love to get back to the community. And our grant recipient is Good Neighbor
Settlement House. Good Neighbor Settlement House. We also want to say thank you to all the nonprofit organizations to give us their opportunity to visit and to learn more about struggles or how they made it and all the information they gave us. Thank you to everyone that was involved.
Can we have the three nonprofit organizations that we did? It was Project Space, Good Neighbor Settlement House, and Bronze Literacy Center come up for our tokens that we have. We'd like to thank you, like, for the opportunity you gave us and experience that we did, that we had going through all of that. Could you three come up, please? No? Actually, I have final words. Good luck to everyone that's taking their final exam, their AP test. I hope all you guys pass. And I know this is a week was kind of stressful for some of y'all because of prom, studying, etc. I hope you guys had a good day.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, so last but not least, we would like to ask Mr. Charles Champion from Veterans Early College High School and his class to please join us. Speaking on behalf of Veterans Early College High School, Heather Diaz, Christian Pineda, and Daniel Sierra.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Veterans Memorial High School, we visited the Museum of Fine Arts as well as the Costumes of America and Children's Museum and also Brownsville Preservation Society. Okay. First off, we would like to thank the Museum of Fine Arts for showing us how art can be showed in many ways and forms. We had a spectacular time looking at all the artists in many different ways. Okay, the Children's Museum, after having a brief talk about how kids enjoyed the place and had a lot of fun, we got to play with the toys ourselves, including the HEB and also many grocery stores. We played tic-tac-toe and had lots of fun, including riding horses. Hands down, the Costumes America was our favorite place, considering it had a space and exhibit, and their mission for the grant was to create a Legoland, because their Legoland right now has only four sets with only four kids able to play, and if we were to give them the grant, that they would use it to make a bigger play space. Costumes of America. These three wonderful women showed everyone how costumes can really touch everyone and how they're very important. They showed us how dazzling they can be, and they were very, very beautiful costumes. They even showed us some sandals that were made out of wood, and we had an amazing time after they give us cookies. The Brownsville Preservation Society came to our school and showed us how much it means to them and Brownsville to preserve houses and buildings that were very old, but they want to keep them So Juan Trey Mendez and Dante Pensa, and our grant goes to the Children's Museum. Okay, hello. The Children's Museum, please come up.
I want to say thank you to the Brownsville Preservation Society, the Museum of Fine Arts. Oh.
We'd like to say thank you to the Brownsville Preservation Society, the Children's Museum, Cops of America.
Thank you so much, and I want to, if we could please give a big round of applause to our two MCs who did a fabulous job, Albert and Christian. Thank you so much. Wow, we always get excited at the end of this event. We see a lot of great things happening in our community and with our kids. They're our future, so we're super excited to see this. At this time, I'd like to see how many seniors do we have in the room? Who's graduating within a few weeks? Could you please stand so we can recognize you? Thank you, seniors. Seniors, no pressure, but this is just the beginning. We hope that you continue to use these tools that you've been given and that you make us proud. At this time, I'd like to recognize we have a BISD board member who joined us, Mr. Erasmo Castro. Thank you so much for your support. We appreciate all you do for our district, and we hope that you can stay and join us for lunch. We have a lunch that was catered by Ricardo's. And once again, we want to thank our two foundations, Brownsville Community Foundation, Brownsville Foundation for Health and Education, for all they do for this initiative. So thank you all so much.